Hi, I'm Marco. Welcome to this talk. Today I'm going to talk about how I avoid to use the mouse as much as possible as a programmer in my daily job. So, of course, there are a lot of ways of doing it, and what I do is a really opinionated way, as all the ways that you can do. So, everything that you'll see is my own way of doing stuff, is not the best one, and so on. But I just want to show you what's my preferred way of doing things. So this is what you are going to talk about. First of all, why I don't like using the mouse, and the first things that you should do if you don't want to use the mouse, in my opinion, is to learn how to use Vim. So I will show you the basics, then I will show you Spacemax, which is an Emacs distribution that comes with the Vim emulation, which is really nice in my opinion. I will show you, and then maybe what I will consider the best of both worlds, so the worlds of an IDE, so a full-fledged bloated IDE like VS Code with the nice Vim stuff and also Spacemax stuff. So I will show you VSpace Code, which is a plugin for VS Code that inside embeds both Spacemax and Vim. So it's going to be an escalation of stuff. At the end, it's not really related to everything, to the Vim discussion, but I will show you i3WM, which is a tiling window manager that is a replacement for something like GNOME, KDE, so your desktop environment. This section cannot be relevant to you if you're using Windows or Mac, but it's going to be relevant only for Linux. But the other stuff is so Vim, Spacemax, and VSpace Code are available also on other operating systems. So, okay, yeah, let's talk about why I don't like the mouse. So, first of all, it hurts. You know, when I use the mouse a lot at work, so I use keyboard, mouse a lot, it hurts a little bit here, the arm, the wrist in reality. And yeah, I'm not a doctor, but when I use the keyboard, my wrist doesn't hurt that much, so that doesn't hurt at all. So I think that for me it's better to use the keyboard as much as possible. And then it's slow because if I'm typing on the keyboard, then I have to switch to the mouse, then I have to go back to the keyboard. And when you're using the mouse, you have to select, you have to be really precise what you're selecting. For me, it's slow. I'm faster if I use the keyboard. And it moves your fingers away from the home row. So what's the home row? So I'm a programmer, and if you bring it to the basics, what a programmer does is just editing text files, whether it is code or documentation. So I think that we should really be good at typing. So, and what's the one thing that they tell you when you are learning to type, let's say? In theory, you should place your fingers like that. So, your left hand should be like this, and the right hand should be like that. And this in the center is what they call the home row. The point is that from my right hand, when I have to use the mouse, I have to move it away from the keyboard, right? And then I have to come back. So when I come back, I cannot reach this position again. I'm lost. So I have always to watch and to reposition it. I do messy stuff. And this doesn't only happen when I use the mouse, but also when I use if the keyboard is really big. It happens also when I go to, for example, page down or page up, or even when I go to the arrow keys. It may be just me, but yeah, this is what happens to me. If I move from this position, I cannot come back to it. And yeah, there are ways to fix this, so to keep your hands in that position without changing them, without moving them. One way of doing it is to use some of the good old editors of that from Unix, yes. And yeah, this meme just summarize them, these old editors. So we have Vim, which is usable in just about any environment. Because when you SSH in a Unix server, it's really likely that you will find Vim or either Vui. Vim is just Vui improved. The M stands for that. And it does one thing, and it does it well. In the sense that it is good, it follows the Unix philosophy. So it does one thing, which is editing text files, and it does it very well, in my opinion. Yes. So Emacs, we have also Emacs, and it is flexible, customizable, and packed with every feature known to man. So. On the contrary, or Vim, which does one thing, Emacs does everything. There are people that read their emails in Emacs, that they have their calendar, they debug code, and so on. And if you think about this, is the approach that modern IDEs like, I don't know, VS Code, IntelliJ, they have really a lot of functionalities inside, like for example the ability to debug, to create projects, I don't know. And this is the approach of Emacs. They want to do everything from Emacs. And then we have Nano, which is really a basic program. It says that it mostly used by people who do not know what they are doing, or psychopaths. So basically, it's used by people that do not know what they are doing, because in a lot of tutorials, when they tell you to edit a file, they just say, okay, just open a terminal and type nano and the name of the file. So that's why this meme says this. But yeah, it's a really basic editor, and it doesn't solve the problem of the mouse for me, so I will just ignore it. Personally, I prefer the Vim way of editing a text file. So if I have to edit a text file, I prefer how Vim let me do it. But as a program in general, I prefer Emacs, because yeah, it has all the functionalities that you will ever need, I think. There is this joke which says that Emacs is a great operating system lacking only a decent editor. And yeah, this is the second, yeah, before we had the meme, this is the joke. So basically all my thoughts are summarized by memes or jokes. I'm a little bit worried, but anyway. So okay, I will show you a demo of Vim, and so let's go. So the first thing that you have to do if you want to learn Vim is to type, yeah, first of all install it, but it may be already installed, is to type Vim. When you install it, you will have this program, Vim Tutor, which is just, it will open like a file, and it will open it in Vui, in Vim. And it will contain a tutorial of Vim, in fact. So it has a lot of different lessons and so on. So, I just copy-pasted this file, and I created a smaller version of it. Here it is. I call it the Vim Tutor Mini. So, let's do it together. First of all, we can move the cursor, this thing here, our cursor, right? Okay, we have screen key and I zoomed in, so we're ready to go. So yeah, you can move your cursor with the arrow keys or with H, J, K and L. So H go to the left, L go to the right, J go down, K go up. So you might say why you want to move your cursor with letters? Well, these letters, if you look at them, they are really near the right position of the home row. So you don't have to move your hand away from the keyboard when you are typing if you want to move your cursor. So that's why they're really useful. So if you can exit Vim by entering command mode, I think, by pressing the column. And then here you see you can type commands, for example, Q for quit. And if you want to discard all the changes you made, you can add the exclamation point. So you can do it. Then let's enter again. Yeah, as you can see, if you want to edit a file, you just type Vim and the name of the file. Okay, so you want to delete a character. You just move your cursor to the character and you press X. So maybe you are asking if I press H or if I press X, you should type the word you should normally if you press H you just write the word the character H. No, in Vim no, it's not like that. Normally you are in normal mode. And in normal mode, letters really execute a command. So for example, when you press J, you say go down, K go up, and so on. If you want to insert a character, with Ctrl E, you just go down without moving your cursor. If you want to insert text, what you have to do is to type I. So you go I and then missing from this line. When you press I, you are in insertion mode. And so if you type letters, they will appear, you know? Okay, when you press Esc, you go back to normal mode. Okay, so with I, what happens is that you insert the text. Here is a cursor. When you press I, you insert text before the letter. But if you want to insert text after the letter, you will press A. So I before the letter, A after the letter. One quick note, I have a slightly modified version of Vim that when I'm in insert mode it has this bar, this little bar, while in normal mode it has this bigger bar. And you might not have it. It's just I use NeoVim in order to achieve it. I don't know if Vim has it, but yeah, it's a little detail. So we said that with I you insert text before the letter, but if you press uppercase I, you insert the letter at the beginning of the line, while if you press A, uppercase A, you go to the end of the line. So this line. So you are here in the middle of the line. For example, you want to type something at the end. Just press A and start typing. It's really handy. Okay, so We have edited the file. Before we just quit Vim without any modification. Right now, if I try to quit, so colon Q without the exclamation mark, it will say that there are some changes, so you cannot just exit. You can either exit without modifying the file, so with the exclamation mark you discard all the changes you've done, but if you want to write what you edited in the file, you just type W. So if you want to write and quit, you just type W and Q. We don't want to do it, so I will not press enter. Okay, so this was the summary, the lesson one. Let's go to lesson two. Okay, so if you want to delete a word, right? Of course you can press like XXXX. We don't want to do it. You can press D for delete and then W for word. And it deletes all the words. So what happened? Normally, W is a motion. So, for example, if you're here and you press W, it will move your cursor to the next, to the beginning of the next word. So you press W, and you're here. You press again W, you will arrive here. For example, if you want to come, go the opposite is B for back. Back, back. So you are here. If you combine D, which if you combine a command, for example D, with the motion, you will apply that command to the letters that are inside, traversed by that motion. So, for example, if you press W from here, that motion will bring you here. So these letters are involved, these characters are involved, right? So if you say DW, you will delete what's inside that motion. So for example, we are here, we want to delete this delete me. Just DW, DW. And we're done with it. Oh, it says hello Linux Day because I just presented this on Italian Linux Day and I'm redoing it in English. Just if you're curious. Okay, so another motion is the dollar sign. The dollar sign, if you remember it from regex, it indicates it stands for the end of the line. So in Vim, if you type dollar sign, it will move your cursor to the end of the line. So, based on what we've said, if you want to delete from here to the end of the line, you just type D dollar and you're done. So this is what I explained to you. You can combine D with every motion. So for example, we say that with B you go back to the previous word. So if you are here and you want to delete this word, you can type D B. So you can combine D with the motion, but D can be whatever command. You have W that bring you the first letter of the next word, but you also have E, which bring you to the end of the current word. So E will bring you here. So if we are here, we can say DE. It will preserve one space. And of course, if you're in the middle of a word, you press DE, it will save that part of the word. Nice. Okay. Now, yeah. Other cool stuff. So in Vim, if you press a number and then you do something, it will repeat the that something that many times. So, if we want to arrive here, we can type www, but we can say to vim 2w two times. So, we can say 2w, and it does w two times. Same thing with, for example, we want to arrive here, right? It's like 1j, 2j, so it's, you can do 1, 2, 3, 4j. So, 4j, that's it. 0 is not really relevant here, I think, but it brings you to the beginning of the line, so it's the opposite of the dollar sign. Dollar sign, 0. 0 brings you to the beginning of the line, but if you remember, in regex you have the this character, and the difference between 0 and this character is that 0 will bring you really to column 0, to the beginning of the line, while this character will bring you to the first character in the line, which is really handy. Okay, so we can combine this with the commands. So, for example, if we want to delete these two words, yeah, again, if we do 2w, it goes here and here. But if we want to delete it, we just put the command d before the motion, so it's d2w. And we deleted it. Okay, then you can delete the whole line with dd, and you can delete, for example, all these lines with there are 6 lines, so 6 dd, you deleted everything, right? So 3dd will delete just 3 lines, and so on. So it's really powerful, this mechanism. Then, notice that in all the editors, every editor has its own way of deleting a line, of doing this stuff, we're doing it, right? Once you learn Vim, in all editors you will delete a line with dd, yeah, it's just one set that you can have on all editors, so don't close the videos. Stay with me because I will show you nice stuff. Then, okay, if you do something by mistake and you want to undo, so Ctrl Z. For example, let's fix this. Let's, I don't know, remove some letters. With U, that stands for undo. You undo what the last change, right? If you want to redo, so for X, Ctrl Y on some editors, you can do Ctrl R. Ctrl R, you undo the undo. Nice. Okay. This is what I explained before. So you have the operator, so what I call it like the command, like delete and stuff like that. The number of time you want to do that. So if you don't specify it, 1 is implied, and then the motion, so W, E, and so on. Okay, so let's copy paste. By default on Y, on Vim, everything is a cut, so there is no delete by default. If you, for example, you delete this, right? This previously, we say delete word. Then, if you type P for paste, it will paste it. So, when you delete something, first you copy it and then you delete it. So basically, if you want to paste something, is P. If you want to copy something without first deleting it, is you do it with Y. Y is the command you want to use. So Y stands for yank. You can say yank and then the motion. For example, I say the word. So if I go here and press P, I just paste what I've copied before. Okay, if you want to replace a character, you go here and you press R for replace, and then the character you want to replace. You want to go here, R, E, and that's it. Okay, this is nice. This is another operator, so it's like delete, but it goes automatically in insert mode. So let's say that you want to change this two words, right? If you want to apply what we already know, it's like we have to do the E, so we deleted it, and then we press E to go in insert mode. There is a faster way, which instead of using D for delete, you use C for change. And change is the same thing as delete, but it goes automatically in insert mode, so you don't have to press the I. So, C, E, and then you start typing. For example, if you want to change this from here to the end of the line, you say C, dollar sign, and you can start typing. Same principle as the applies here. Okay, we are done with Vim for now. Let's go back to our presentation. So we said that basically Vim is different from other editors because it has these mods which are really powerful. The normal mode, so you, oh, this is Italian. Okay, sorry Dante Alighieri. Now it's English. So in normal mode you can do commands like move your cursor, delete, and you can do them from with your keyboard, from your normal keys. You don't have to press Ctrl Alt something. With Emacs, I haven't used Emacs really without using GUI inside Emacs. So the vanilla Emacs experience is that, from what I know, is that you have to do this stuff. You have to always press Ctrl and other strange combinations, while in Vim you can do a lot by just using the letters of your keyboard. You don't have to press Ctrl for everything, which in my opinion is really a big selling point. Then you have the insertion mode, where you can actually insert text, and then you have the visual mode, which we will see later. It basically lets you select text. So, if you're wondering, this is the keyboard where Vim was written. So, you can notice the arrow keys on the characters, and you can spot why those letters really moves the cursor in this way. So, one thing to notice here is that this means end in Italian. This, you notice this, the position of Ctrl and Esc. So right now Ctrl is to the bottom of the keyboard and Esc is on the top of the keyboard. So they are not really handy. It's not really comfortable to press them. So what I did is I moved them in the caps lock key. If you look at your keyboard, the caps lock key is right on the home row. It's really easy to press, and so that's what I did. If I press caps lock and another key, for example caps lock C, it copies, while because it the caps lock works as a control. Well, if I just press caps lock and then I release it, so if I press caps lock alone, it acts as ESC, as the ESC key. Solution on Linux. if you can use this to, I use this to commands. So if you do this, control is acts as ask when you press it alone. While if you execute this command, basically caps clock becomes the new control, and you can activate caps lock by pressing both the shift keys on your keyboard. Okay, so Vim is really nice. I mean, Vim, editing a file in Vim is really nice, in my opinion. But a lot of people will tell you that you cannot use Vim at your programming job because it's not really powerful as other IDEs. I can agree at some point, until a certain point, because I am on the opinion that configuring Vim to become a full-fledged IDE is not really that convenient. In fact, what I prefer to do, in fact, is to emulate Vim inside other IDEs. I mean, if you try writing Java by using Vim, it's not the same thing as doing it with the IntelliJ IDE or with the Eclipse. I mean, in my opinion, it's not really possible to achieve the same degree of experience. Or if you can achieve it, you have to spend a lot of time to configure Vim, for sure. So, what you get when you emulate Vim inside other IDEs is coherent text editing, which is what I was mentioning before. When you have to delete a line on other IDEs, it's a pain. I mean, you go to VS Code and they have a key binding. You have to go to IDE IntelliJ and they have another key binding. I don't know, it may be Control K, I don't know. I just bring Vim with me inside all the IDEs that I happen to use. And so editing, deleting the current line for me is just DD. I just forgot all the other possible shortcuts in other IDEs. I forgot them. I just edit with Vim. And it's nice because, for example, you can do vertical selection in Vim is Control V. And once you emulate Vim inside your other IDEs, vertical selection will always be Control V or Control V, I don't know. It's nice for me. So, yeah, Vim is not powerful as other IDEs, but the reality is that you can integrate Vim inside your favorite IDE. And I had a really good time doing it. So, perfect. You're learning some Italian today, so thank me later. The perfect editor for me, it has to have Vim emulation, as we said. It has to be for sure powerful, extensible, and customizable. So I cannot use Vim as my editor because I want to debug my code inside my editor. I want to have a Git plugin. I want to show images, show everything. I want to do everything inside my editor, okay? I'm more an Emacs person than a UI person. When we talk about editor, I don't care about the Unix way, okay? This is a really opinionated opinion. I mean, it's questionable, but it is my way of doing stuff. Of course, someone will say you can have debugger inside Vim, you can have Git inside. Yes, you can do it, but it's not that easy. And so the perfect editor has to have a decent default configuration. That's why vanilla Vim or Vanilla Emacs are not an option for me. I don't want to build a full-fledged IDE that has all I need starting from Vanilla Vim or Vanilla Emacs. I cannot do it. It's to me, it's a waste of time because I have a lot of demands. I need a lot of stuff from my IDE, and configuring it from scratch, it will be really a pain. So, what you may consider as the best editor, what I might consider as the best editor, could be Spacemax. Spacemax is a community-driven Emacs distribution. So, these guys, this community, started from Vanilla Emacs, and together they built it's like a set of configuration files from Emacs. You can see it in this way. So, one, they said, maybe they said, okay, let's do the work of creating a really nice Emacs environment, a Emacs distribution, but let's do it once together. So it's not like everyone is doing its own thing. These guys are creating a really nice thing, a really nice Emacs set of Emacs config files together. This is how you can see it. Their motto is that the best editor is neither Emacs nor Vim, it's Emacs and Vim. Because what they've done is that they package it together with this distribution. They packaged the evil mod, which is the Vim emulation for Emacs, and it works really well. So I will show you Spacemax now. Okay, we are inside the Spacemax, and as you can see, we have the cursor from Vim. And yeah, I mean, we are inside Emacs, but we can edit files like we are in Vim. What does it mean? It means that if I want to use Vim, I just use Vim. If I want to use something from Emacs, for example, orgmod or magit, I can use Emacs without any problems. So I'm able to use Vim and Emacs at the same time. I can use both. And for me, it's the same. I never say, oh, I'm in Vim, so this doesn't work. For me, it's the same, and it's great. You can, if you work like this with Vim emulation, you can use every IDE and you're comfortable in it. I cannot pronounce it. Let's continue the tutorial that we left before, but let's do it in Spacemax. So by pressing G, capital G, you go to the bottom of the file. Yeah, here it says bottom. While, yeah, this, you can see that here it gives you, it tells you where you are on the file. So if you want to do page up in Vim, is Control B, which is for backward. While if you want to do page down, it's Control F, which stands for forward. So Control F, and you can see that this nice stuff tells you where you are. Now, if you want to move to the beginning of the file, you just press GG instead of, because G stands for go, okay? So GG, you go to the beginning of the file. Then, Control O and Control I think about it as Control Out and Control In. They move your cursor back and forward, okay? So, for example, previously you were here, right? Let's toggle line numbers. Toggle line numbers, absolute line numbers. I will explain what I just did. Basically, if you want to go I'm here on line 17, right? I go GG and I go to the top. If I want to go back, so out, I just say Ctrl O and it moves you to the previous position of the cursor. If you want to go back where I was before, so it's like in, Ctrl I. So Ctrl O, you go back in time, Ctrl E, you go, you move forward in time, like your cursor position. You got it, I think. Search, if you want to search something, you type the slash character, and here it appears, and you can search, for example, the word error. When you start typing, space mask is really nice because it highlights the words that you are searching. Vim does not do it by default, I think. You are satisfied, you want to search for ER, you press just enter. And this is your position, the cursor position. If you want to go to the next word, you press N, that stands for next, and you go next. Well, if you want to go backward, you just press capital N. In Vim, sometimes if a letter does something, when you do the capital of version of that letter, so you press shift and that letter, it does the opposite. Sometimes it's like that. The really nice thing about the searching in Vim is that it doesn't open another a dialogue, right? A little dialogue that you have to move your mouse and press buttons. You want to go to the you want to search for this word. Yeah, you just type error. You press enter and you're here. You can do stuff. And the nice thing is that, for example, you arrive here and you want to add a word. You added it, but you are, I mean, the search is still there. So if you press N, it resumes your previous search. So you can edit stuff, and you can continue to explore that word. Yeah, for example, one thing that I do is, let's say that I want to change this error in error. I mean, I want to fix this error. I just type, okay, error, I go here, and I say that I want to, let's say that we want to change it. I say, let's remove this and this with the X. Then you go next, and you can do the same. This is a slow way of doing it. For example, what you can do is, okay, I'm here. You see, I just press N, it resumes my previous search. I say, change word, and you type, I don't know, new word, okay? Then I press ESC. In Vim, if you press dot, just the dot, it will repeat your last change, I think. So if I press N and then I just press the point character, it applies that change to that word. It's really nice. For example, you are here and you go to the beginning of the line and you add beginning. Then you are here and you say, oh, you know what, I want to add the beginning at the end of this line too. You can do it manually, but if you press point, it does it. It's magical. This saves you a lot of time. Okay, now, matching parentheses is cool too. If you press the percentage sign, it will go to the opposite parentheses. So for example, this parentheses here is closed by this one. So if I press percentage, it goes to that parentheses. This parentheses is closed by this one. So if I go here and I press percentage, it goes to the opposite parentheses. This is really nice because if you have a function and here you have a really long code, you just press percentage and you go to the beginning of it. Yeah, for example, here I don't want to anticipate, but okay, let's do one nice thing. I will explain something. If you want to go to the end of the file, you can press capital L, which stands from low. I want to go back here, I press control O. I want to go back to my previous position. I want to cancel from here to the end of what I'm currently seeing. See, right? What I currently see. So we said if I press L, I go here. So this is a motion. I want to delete until that motion. So D, capital L. Great. If you want to substitute, for example, best with worst, you say column to go to common mode, S to substitute, then slash the word you want to substitute, space max is really nice, it highlights with red, slash worst, slash G, and G works for this current line. For example, if you want to have a dialogue, I mean, if you want to, for example, we want to replace the word every with something. So in all the file, we have to say column percentage, which means all the file, S, then every, since we added the percentage, it highlights all the every word in the file. Then we want to replace it with new. And then I added G, so if I press enter, it replaces all the occurrences. But let's undo it. I want to do something different. So I say column to go to my to go here. If I go up, it resumes my previous search. If I want to be prompted, I just say GC. So GC, it tells me replace every with new. So this one, I can say yes. Okay, this is the next occurrence of every. Replace every with new. Here I can say no. So I just replaced this one. Okay, so let's say that we want just to quickly run a command inside our editor. We can do column, exclamation mark, and then, for example, I don't know, ls. And here it gives the output. For example, I can say date. And here it shows the output, is maybe handy. You can also write what you're editing inside a file. So if you want just to save, it's W for write, but so column W. But if you want to write this content to a new file, it's W and then name of the file. Okay, for example, if you want just to save one part of the file, you can use the selection mode. The visual mode, let's say. So, if you press V, you enter visual mode, and you can select text. In the same way as you move inside the file. So for example, you can press J or A, L, and so on. So here you are selecting a part of the text, so you can say Y for yank, and for example you can paste it with P and so on. You can also select a part of this and then column W and the file name, and you will write only this part to a file name. Okay, we saw that we can execute you can execute a command with the exclamation mark, oops, column exclamation mark ls, but we can insert the output of the command inside our file. So for example, you have to do column r and then your command. So like this, exclamation mark ls, it will insert what is printed from that command. So for example, if you want to type the date, you can do r and then date. Okay, then you have o, which inserts a new line, and it goes directly into insert mode. So O, and you are in insert mode on the next line. Then, if you remember, I told you that sometimes in Vim, if you press Shift and that command, that letter, it does the opposite, right? So in this case, if you press Shift and O, so capital O, instead of creating a new line down, it will create a new line up. So, like this. Okay, yeah, we just saw this. With the A you can append. This is not really useful. You can, I mean, I don't use it, but if you do capital R, you enter this, I think it's the replace mode, I don't know, and you can type characters and they will be substituted to the other one. I never use this. Okay, we saw copy pasting, for example. I told you that you can, once you learn one motion, you can use it with every command. So for example, we saw that with dollar, you go to the end of the line, right? And we saw that you can delete with until the end of the line with the dollar. This also works with the change or for example with yank. So you can do yank dollar, so you copy paste it until the end of the line, and here you can paste it. So same thing, for example, we say that dd delete the line with yy, it yanks the current line, and with p you can paste it. Okay, so last stuff, there are these objects that are sentence and paragraph, which might be nice to use. So sentence, it indicates words that are inside a point, right? That are before a point, let's say. So this the first sentence of this paragraph will be this one, while a paragraph instead is just some letters that are between two new lines. So this is a paragraph, for example, and you can say like delete around sentence, and this is what it deletes. Or you can say delete around paragraph, and it will delete this thing, delete around paragraph. Okay, And yeah, you can use this inside, and this is all. No, this is around, not outside. You can use this in different ways. For example, if you want to, I mean, the difference is that with inside they preserve what surrounds the object. For example, let's say that you have this. Hello. Hi. Hello. I don't know. If you say, let's make this a little bigger. If you say change inside parentheses, it will preserve the parentheses, and here you can edit. But if you want to completely delete the parentheses, you can say change around parentheses, and it you can write, but the parentheses are eliminated. Same thing with, for example, angular bracket. Change inside angular bracket, it will delete it. Okay, I want to show you just one little thing about Vim, which are macros. They are amazing. So, for example, let's say that we want to add double quotes around all these words, right? For example, let's say that we are doing a JSON or something like that. You can do it like this, and it's a little bit slow. Imagine that you have 100 of these. So we can do it faster. Of course, if you have like hundreds of these. Let's say that we want to use a macro for this. With Q, you say to Vim that you want to record the macro. So I press Q, and then you have to assign this macro to a letter. So for example, I want to record a macro associated to the letter A. Okay, so I pressed Q A, and then you see that I'm recording a macro. A macro is just some commands that now I will input in the program, and these commands will be executed but also recorded in order to be used later. So first thing that I want to do is just go to the beginning of the line. So I press 0. Then with W, I go to the first word that I want to edit. Then I want to add... one thing that you can do with Spacemax is surround. So you select what you want to surround. Then you press S and character, so double quotes. And then... you go to the next line with J, and the macro is over. So you can just press Q to say that it says that the macro has been defined, you see? Okay, so now what you want to do is to execute this macro, right? For all the other lines. In order to do it, you press at, and then the name of the macro, so the letter that we assigned, right? In this case, it was A, so I press at, and then A. And it executes the same commands that we ran before. So I can go to the next line, and you say at a. But for sure you can do better. For example, you can say that you want to repeat that macro twice. So you can say to at a. So if you have 100 of these, you say 100 at A, and you've done. These are macros, okay. So basically what I showed you until now, all the commands that we saw, they work also on Vim. Spacemax, I like Spacemax because also because it has this switch key menu, which is bundled, is enabled by default. And if you press space, which is the reason why it's called Spacemax, it gives you a lot of commands that you can run. And these commands are all organized hierarchically and in a mnemonic way, let's say. So for example, if you press space and then F, you access to all the commands related to files. Let's see, I press space F, and then here for example we have S for save, or capital S to save all, and I don't know, F to find file. So for example, you are here. I mean, yeah, you can press F from here. So we press the space F and then F, and it will open a file browser. So you can browse it with Control J and Control K, or with your arrow keys. Then you press Enter, and it opens the file that you want to open. So with space tab, you go to the last buffer. And I don't know, you have also, for example, one cool thing is that you have space W for Windows. And for example, with the slash, you do a split to the right. So it splits the window to the right. So I don't know, you do space tab again, and now you are editing two files at once. If you want to move to the right, to the window to the right, you don't have to take the mouse and click here. You can just do space W, and then L is window right, so space W L, and it goes to the right. Let's see, we have space W D for delete window, and you say okay, space W D. You delete that window. So you can see that you have a lot of these. For example, you have also Git. What I've done before is D for all the toggles, and then you have N for number, if I remember correctly. Line numbers, here it is, and then you can choose for example relative line numbers, and with relative line numbers you have in the cursor that in the line of the cursor you have the absolute line number, but here you have relative. This is useful, for example, if you want to go here, you can say just 7j, and you go there. For example, you want to toggle the line wrap, it's like space T L, and it will put it to the right. Space T L, it goes before. I don't know about you, but I couldn't remember all these key bindings in a normal editor, because probably this will be something like Control Alt and something that is not really mnemonic, right? So SpaceMax gives you all this cool stuff. So we can say that SpaceMax gives you these mnemonic bindings and hierarchically organized. And then one other cool thing about SpaceMax is the help system. So SpaceMax, you can. Just by pressing space, you can discover all these key bindings. But for example, let's say that you want to. We are in this situation, right? I do a vertical split, and you are curious what space WL does. Okay, I mean it's really easy, but let's say that you want to know to read its documentation. Okay. What you can do is let's close this with Woody. What you can do is space H for help, D for describe, and key for describe key. Okay, so now he's telling me describe the we have to enter the key that we want to describe. So we said space W L. And here you can see the documentation. So space WL runs the command evil window right. And here it tells you, okay, you can also do control W right, Control WL. This works only also in Vim. And so you can see that this key, base WL, this key binding, is associated to this function evil window write. So you have two options here. You can execute, you can go write either by pressing space WL or by running that function, so evil window write. So if you press space here, you have a list of all the functions that you can run. So if you search, you, for example, you don't remember that you go to the right with base WL. You just remember that you want to go right. So window right, okay? And it does a fuzzy search on all the available functions. And it says, okay, there is this function that is mapped to space WL. If you just press enter, it will run this function. It's the same as if you pressed the space WL by yourself. And this mapping between functions and keys is something that I was not able to reproduce in Vim. I don't know if you can do it. And it's something that I really like about Emacs. Just a side note, if you want to try SpaceMax, use the develop branch, because the master is not really updated. Besides being a really nice idea, SpaceMax is also nice because they defined a set of key bindings which are really great, in my opinion. As we said, they are easy to remember, they are organized hierarchically. So with Vim, we already achieved coherent shortcuts regarding editing text, like deleting file, vertical selection. But SpaceMax defines also shortcuts related to IDE actions, such as compiling your project, searching in the whole project. For example, compiling is space CC, while searching in project is space SP for search project. So if SpaceMax doesn't work for you, because for example, you might say, well, I don't want to write Java code inside Emacs, right? It's more or less is the same problem we had in VI. You can bring the SpaceMax IDE shortcuts with you in your favorite IDE, as we already done with Vim. So there are a bunch of projects that brings SpaceMax key bindings to different IDE. For example, we have I think that they are all of them more or less. They are available for Eclipse, IntelliJ, Vim itself, and VS Code. So at the beginning, I think that there were just these two, Vim and VSpace Code. Then I did Eclipse and IntelliJ, and now I am also the maintainer of the VSpace Code together with another guy. And I think that for me, VS Code is better than IntelliJ and Eclipse, because with VS Code, VSpace Code, we also emulated the WhichKey menu. So I will show you. But I am in VS Code. You can install VSpace Code by going to extensions and searching for VSpace Code. And it's this one. You just click install here, and it's done. It's really easy, the process, while with the other ones is a little bit more complicated. And so when you press space, you get the same menu as you have in SpaceMax. Well, it's not really the same, because it's not the same. What we've done is bind the VS Code actions that you can access with Ctrl Shift P. Here you have all the action of VS Code, And what we are doing is binding these actions to the most similar k-bindings of SpaceMax. So for example, we said that Sershin project is space SP in SpaceMax. So here you type space and it opens the which key menu. Then you can see that on with S you get search. So let's type S. And then with P you have searching project. So let's type P. And here you can see I can search for print, and it is searching. So if you're interested in VSpace Code, we have a nice website where you can see the demo here. And here we have also the docs. So if you go to the docs, we have installation instructions. Yeah, we're doing a good job, I think. So for example, here in the bonus section, you have the quick window navigation, which let you It let you move among all the windows of VS Code with Control H J. For example, I'm here, so Control L moves me here, Control J goes here in the terminal, Control K goes here. I can go to this menu here, and here you can the file manager is you can browse it with HJK and L, so it's nice. Control L, I go to this one, so you can really use VS Code mostly without using your mouse. So of course we have the file browser as in SpaceMax, which is achieved with another extension, so on. So what I want to tell you is that it's that, in my opinion, you should use the editor that solves your problem better. So for example, if you're editing in Java, you can use Eclipse or IntelliJ. If you bring the SpaceMax and Vim key bindings with you, you can use the same key bindings on all your IDs, and you feel like home with whatever ID you're using in that moment. Okay, so we talked about your editor, and more or less we achieved the fact that we can use our editor without using our mouse, right? But what about the rest? I mean, if you're using GNOME or KDE, or even Windows, I don't know, you still have to move Windows around, you have to click to move your mouse to select different Windows and so on. So the solution to this is to use a tiling window manager. For example, I use i3wm, but there are different ones. For example, there is bspwm, dwm. I recently discovered that there is also there are some scripts for KDE that let you use KDE as a tiling window manager. You can search for something like, you can search for KDE Kwin tiling. If you search something like that, you will find it on Google. Oh, let's see, I want to do the zoom. Is like space, Z for zoom, then X for font, and then plus. Okay. Anyway. So I will explain what tiling window manager is are. So there are two approaches when you have to manage Windows. One is floating, which is the classical one that you see on traditional desktop environments, and one is tiling. So floating, it means that you open a window, and I mean, every time you open a window, it's opened in a in a little window like that, and it's floating. So if you open another one, it's maybe it will hide the other one, and I don't know. For me, it's a traditional mode, right? For me, it doesn't really make a lot of sense. There is another approach, which is tiling. So I will show you. I will show it to you. Okay, so here we are on my desktop, and for example, let's try to. I am on i3wm, which is a tiling window manager. So for example, let's try to open Firefox. You can see that a tiling window manager will display an application by using all the pixels, okay? For example, let's try to open another one, for example, my terminal, which is I have bound to Windows Enter. As you can see, every time you open a new window, the tiling window manager will split the available space in half. Let's try to open another, I don't know, another instance of Firefox. So it reduces the space of the windows in a smart way. Let's say it doesn't just overlap all your windows like a normal desktop. For example, let's say that we don't want to open a terminal vertically, but we want to open it right here down. So what I do is press Windows V, which stands for vertical, and then I can say open a terminal and it will open here. So if I open another terminal, it will open it here because we are still in that vertical mode. So let's close this with Windows Q. If I press Windows Shift V, it goes back to normal. So when I open another window, it will open it on the right. So this is how i3wm behaves. Not every window manager behaves like that. For example, there are some other ones that assign an application to be the master. And that master window is always the bigger one, mostly. And the other ones are the smallest one. But yeah, i3wm works in this way. For example, let's say that we are in this configuration. These are the workspaces. So right now I'm on workspace 5, okay? I can press Windows 6 to go on workspace 6, and here I can open other stuff. I don't know, for example, well, another instance of. Okay, let's open Eclipse. I don't know. Now, for example, let's open also another terminal. Okay, this is our configuration for workspace 6. If I press Windows 5, I go back to Windows to the previous workspace, so it let you organize your work in a nice way. Of course, you have these virtual desktops or workspaces, whatever you want to call them, also in traditional desktop environments like GNOME or KDE, but the thing that you can assign numbers to them is really useful. So, for example, I am here on Firefox, and let's say that I want to move this window to the other workspace, so workspace 6, for example. I can press Windows Shift 6, and it moved this instance of Firefox. Or, for example, let's say that I want to view these windows all maximized. I can press Windows W. And you can see that here it shows me the name of these windows, and I can move between them with the windows H and L because I configured the Vim bindings for i3wm. Once you learn Vim, you will use Vim bindings everywhere. For example, I want to quit from this. I say Windows Shift W. And if you're here, for example, on Workspace 5, in order to work through these windows, you don't have to use your mouse. So if you want to go here, you don't have to click here. You can move with, again, with Vim keys. So Windows H, go to the left, Windows L, Windows K, and so on. So this is the way I like to work. So let's see pros and cons of telling window managers. The first is that they are small and that they are fast. Since they are simple, they are faster than, for example, GNOME or KDE. So if you have a slow PC, you might enjoy using it. Then, of course, as we said, programs do not overlap. They are always shown side by side, and in this way, you use all the pixels of your screen. Then the nice thing that we are interested in is that they are keyboard driven. You don't have to use your mouse in order to go back and forward between windows. And yeah, one thing I like is that they are configurable with plain text files. Instead with, I don't know, KDE or GNOME, you have the settings. Yeah, I mean, this is both a pro and the cons. Because let's see the cons. The cons is that they are not ready out of the box and they are for power users only. This one, the Tiling Window Manager, really are for power users only. Because, yeah, the thing that you have to configure them from config files, this is one aspect, but another aspect is that more often than not, this Tiling Window Manager do only one thing or just a few more, which is managing your windows, managing how windows are displayed on your screen. If you take, for example, GNOME or KDE, they do much more. They have settings for Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, battery power management, and so on. This Tiling Window Manager, they only do Windows stuff, right? They respect the Unix philosophy. So this means that if you want to use them, you have to configure everything by yourself. So I don't know, night mod, you have to install the applet for the Wi-Fi, you have to install stuff in order to manage your power settings. You have to install the lock screen. The cons is that they are not for everyone, and they are not ready out of the box. It's not like you install KDE and you have a full functioning PC. When you install a Tiling Window Manager and you configure it, you learn a lot about Linux. So if you're interested in learning about Linux, one thing that I did is that I installed Arch Linux, as you can see from my background, because the meme is true. So every Arch Linux user has to tell that he uses Arch Linux. So one thing that I did is to install Arch Linux from scratch, and then installing i3wm and all these other stuff. For example, this is Rofi that let you run the applications. So my point is, if you want to learn Linux, it might be you may learn a lot by installing a distro from the bottom up. For example, there is Arch, there is Void Linux, Gentoo, I think. So you install everything on top of it step by step. But if you're just interested in having a PC that is already functioning by default, and everything works fine, everything is perfectly integrated, stay away from telling window managers. One thing you can try is that kwin scripts of KD that I was mentioning before. Okay, first thing that I did back like some years ago, I wanted to try i3wm, and I didn't install the Arch Linux from scratch and I installed i3wm. No, first thing I've done is I tried it on VirtualBox. So I installed Manjaro i3wm Community Edition on VirtualBox. So you can do this, it's really simple. You will not damage your current system, and you try i3wm and you see how it goes and if it works for you. There is also Regolith Linux, which is a distro based on Ubuntu. So this one is if you want to stay on an Ubuntu based system, and this one if you want to stay on an Arch based system. Okay, I think that we are done. So I just shared a lot of stuff, I know, but I think that from this point you can do your research. You can do, maybe you can check out my YouTube channel if you want to see if I uploaded related content to this, other related content to this topic, or there is my website, Twitter, LinkedIn, okay, whatever. But yeah, from this point I named a lot of tools you can do your research. Okay, thank you for watching. If you definitely subscribe if you want to see more of this, and please leave a like if you liked the video. Thank you.